Good morning. Thank you, everyone, for attending this health services panel special meeting. It's very early. This morning, we have on the agenda review findings of means test mechanism for Samaritan Fund and Community Care Fund medical assistance programs. At the meeting of the 19th of November, the administration briefed members on the review findings of the means test mechanism for SF and CCF medical assistance programs, MAS, and at that meeting, members have agreed to hold a special meeting to seek views from deputations, and the Secretariat has prepared an updated background brief, CB bracket 2391/1819/01, for members' reference. Now, would the Secretariat please invite deputations and individuals to come in? And also, the administration will be receiving 20 deputations and individuals today, and we have also received written submissions from 3 deputations which will not attend the meeting. Good morning. Good morning, Deputy Secretary, Undersecretary. Good morning, welcome to the special meeting of the panel on health services. I am Pierre Chen, chairman of this panel. May I remind deputations and individuals attending this meeting that you're free to use the EPs in front of you, and you can choose the channels, 0 being the floor, 1 being Cantonese, 2 being English, and 3 being Putonghua. And I'd like to remind everyone expressing your views here that you are not protected under the Legislative Council Pass and Privileges Ordinance Cap 382. Similarly, the written submissions provided by you are not protected under the ordinance. And please note the various security measures in the matters to note for members of the public attending or observing meetings in the lecture complex. The notice have been forwarded to you by the Secretariat, and there is also a copy in front of you. And members of the public in the public gallery can seek a copy of this notice from the security staff of the Legislative Council. And I will follow the seating plans order to invite you to speak. In the interest of time, you'll be given 3 minutes each to speak, and if you'd like to submit further views on the matter, please do so in the form of writing and give it to the Secretariat after the meeting. Good morning, Undersecretary. Would you like to listen to deputations first? So let's begin with Mr. Yip Man Ban. Thank you, Chairman. I am the Deputy Spokesperson on Healthcare Policies of DAB. I am Yip Man Ban. On this issue, the HA and the CCF, in terms of the Samaritan Fund and the CCF MAP, they have proposed various enhancement measures. I feel that these measures are still not adequate and further enhancement is needed. We're concerned about 2 points in particular. First, in terms of the patients annual contribution to drug expenses, it should be adjusted upwards. Although the calculation for the ADFR, that is annual disposable financial resources, have been adjusted, and that is to say the disposable capital have been deducted by 50% and the definition of household has been modified, the cap in relation to the patient's contribution to drug expenses will be maintained at $1 million, which is still apparently on the high side. The DAB and I have the view that the patient copayment ratio should be further lowered. For example, 10% of the ADFR or $500,000 to effectively alleviate financial burden on the patient and the patient's family. Second, in relation to the definition of household, we believe that the definition can be further relaxed. The administration's proposal is that the definition of household should be modified to reduce the number of household members. However, under the revised definition, it is still possible that the patient and the patient's family may still be in financial hardship. We believe that the patient is already suffering from the illness and that it is unreasonable to impose a financial burden on the patient and the household. The definition therefore should be further refined so that the patient will be treated as a single person household without giving regard to the household income of the patient, to make the two programs more tailor-made for the patients. Well, I think that it would take us more than a day to discuss how we can further enhance the mechanism. Now, in terms of the means test mechanism, we believe it is important to, first of all, lower the cap of patient copayment and also refine the definition of household. Next, Mr. Chen Wai-kit. Thank you, Chairman. I represent the Cancer Patient Alliance. Our organization assists cancer patients. We agree with the revisions on this occasion, but we'd like to propose four suggestions. Now, well, each patient will be eligible for $6,000 or $7,000 after the deduction. But for a grassroots earning some $20,000 a month after the deduction of drug expenses, there wouldn't be much savings left. It actually disincentivizes the patient from working. Next, we don't agree with the term discretion. The purpose of the revision is to help alleviate the patient's financial burden and to relax the definition of household to avoid family conflicts. Well, if the social worker would be given discretion in deciding whether the allowance would be given this year, but maybe not next year, then it is totally against the grain and against the logic. And it will also create conflict between the patient and the social worker. There should be a dual-track system for existing or new applicants of SF, Samaritan Fund. The contribution amount should not be more than the original sum. Well, at the moment, the amount may increase because of dependent parents or adult children who are dependent in the family. And the patient is so filial already. Why should we ask the patient to pay more? A third point on the privately purchased medical items, PPMI. I think the Samaritan Fund should work better with pharmaceutical companies in getting discounts. At the moment, the pharmaceutical companies or the suppliers offer 60 or 70% discount. That is, patients would be given 30-40% off the price. And what should be done by the SF should to help those in financial hardship? Because for cancer drugs, we're talking about over 1,000, over 10,000, 20,000, even $40,000 to $50,000 a month. So why must the cap of 1 million be maintained if it's $400,000 to $500,000? It's already eating into the savings of the household. Finally, we hope that this will be implemented as soon as possible, and there should be a review 1 year down the road so that we can adopt more innovative thinking in helping patients. Next, Mr. Chiu Ho Lam. Good morning. Good morning, Undersecretary. I'd like to make 4 points. And I have a question for HA as well as the Food and Health Bureau. Let's say if there is a new drug that could treat our condition, the HA will refuse using the new drug to treat us. That means we'll have to use our own savings to buy new drugs. But after testing the drug for 1 or 2 months, there could be problems and that the drug may not work. But since we're covered by the SF or the CCF, no refund is allowed, and then we return to another drug. And then subsequently, we may find that in fact, the original drug has fewer alternatives or side effects. So I wonder whether we can have a trial period for the privately purchased drugs to see if the drugs work. Second point, it's very difficult for chronically ill patients to get a job. Drugs are available, but we may not have the means to purchase them. On the other hand, we may die very soon if we don't use new drugs. Well, our disease may not be cured, but at least new drugs could prolong our lives. So, and we also have a new forms of drugs, not for oral use. Well, let's say if we obtain subsidy under the CCF or SF, we may be able to buy expensive drugs. But this drug may be administered by injection, and there may be other consumables such as cotton balls. And these consumables are not covered by the CCF or SF. In each hospital, there is a rehabilitation shop. I wonder if subsidy can be given for purchase of these items such as syringes or cotton balls from these rehab shops, so that for ultra expensive drugs or powdered form drugs, they can still be purchased.
Yeah.
So why doesn't government do something like that to help the patients? And for syringes? Well, they may not cost a lot, but then you are spending billions of dollars to reclaim land to build an artificial island, but you are not willing to spend a little amount on the patients. Patients can't afford, so all these items, I hope the government can help us. Next one, Mr. Lee Kaho. Thank you, Chairman. Good morning, everyone. I'm from the Civic Party. The government has always emphasized that the public healthcare policy is that the people will not be denied medical services because of lack of means. That is stated in the paper today. But you are not doing what you said. We have the SF and CCF, which provide assistance on healthcare services. But then there is a means test for these two schemes. And it is a household-based means test. And as a result, the drug cost poses a burden not only to the patient, but also the whole family, including the spouses and other members of the family. And some patients, in order to get the assistance after the means test, a lot of tragedies result, for example, divorce. Many chronic patients need assistance, and they can't work because of their illness, and they can only count on their savings to fend for themselves. Even if they've got the assistance, their life will become more difficult, irrespectively. So in this year, the government said that it will review the means test for these two schemes and revision will be made. The Civic Party welcomes that. But we think that in terms of the proposal, there is room for improvement in order to better help members of the public. First, we have to take a snapshot of the assets at the time of application. The government proposes a revision to the calculation of ADFR to better protect the patients. The proposal is to have a discount of 50% of the disposable capital. We think that that will not effectively protect the patients, even if there is a 50% discount. Well, as I said, many patients can't work, so their assets will get lower and lower ever. So if there is a means test every year, the assistance will get less and less every year. So the assets should be frozen for 5 to 10 years until the illness, the patient fully recovers from his disease, to offer the maximum protection to the patients. We also propose an appeal mechanism be set up because the screening mechanism now is not transparent. And if the patients don't get the assistance, there is no way the patients can appeal. So we propose that an appeal mechanism be established, an appeal panel be established, so that the patients can get a fair chance to lodge an appeal. We also believe that we should adopt a Bayesian-based approach, and there should not be any screening, and there should not be restrictions on the drugs to be prescribed. Thank you. Next one, Mr. Choi Kwong-sam. Thank you, Chairman. I am representing patients suffering from blood diseases. I have reservations on the revised proposal, and we are increasing the subsidy by 12%, which lags behind the increase in prices of drugs. Now, for the present mechanism, there are a lot of loopholes, but these are not mentioned in the report, not to mention putting in enhancement. The mechanism to include drugs in the drug formulary is not transparent. There is a therapy, a drug for blood diseases. It's it costs $200,000 per year, but the HA refuses to include that in the drug list. Now, there are stringent mechanisms in including drugs in the formulary. So the patients are in appalling conditions. The government is serving on the reserve for $4 to $5 million. Is it too miserly? We don't have a good mechanism to assess the cost effectiveness of the drug. The government has all the say in terms of the decision-making policy. The patient's affordability is not properly taken into account, and patients are not given any representation. We should allow, we should include more allowances in the formula. More items should be included on a macro level. We see so many problems today, and that's because there has been a mistake in the policy decision process. It's a civic right for patients to be treated appropriately. Now, you're asking people, the patients, to pay for their for the drug costs. It's like double taxation. So patients are in a plight, and it's like we are living in history where in the Roman period, there was an amphitheater, and the patients had to fight against some enemies before they could get drugs. Well, the assistance from the funds is not granted based on the diseases. For example, we are spending $5.7 billion for 1 kilometer of the SCL, and that is equal to the total expenditure of drugs in the HA. And this amount can be used to help patients. Now, let me cite an example. Well, 100 meters, the cost of 100 meters of railway can help 4,400 patients. And very often, expenditure of on drugs lags behind that for education and other livelihood policies. Our healthcare structure, healthcare infrastructure is very backward. We lag behind the third world. We don't have insurance, so on and so forth. Next, Mr. Lee Kwok-kong. I am suffering from AS, ankylosing spondylitis, for 25 years. I'm going to read from an article written by a professor, which is on AS. Professor Lee said that the earlier the right drugs are used, the better it is for the patients. It can help prevent the condition of the patients deteriorating. But then the drug is very costly. It is not affordable by every patient. So the drug prescription criteria should be relaxed. The patients should work together with their doctors to reflect our concerns to the authorities. In fact, many AS patients are young males. Close to 25% will lose their working ability in 7 years. This will affect their families, and the social burden is heavy. And the prevalence of this disease is not so high as that of diabetes. But then the cost for treating the disease is double than that of other chronic diseases. Now, we are an advanced society. It's not that we don't have drugs to treat us. The government and the drug manufacturers should make available the drugs to the AS patients. Well, I share the view of this article. I hope that you can review the clinical guidelines and criteria. No matter how refined or enhanced your scheme is, well, it doesn't work. And earlier, the health services panel passed a motion moved by Mr. Raymond Chan. So I would like to ask the government, how will you follow up on that motion? Next one, Mr. Tim Pang. The SOCO comprises members from a dozen or so patient groups. We welcome the government and the HA's a review on the means test mechanism, and there will be a redefinition of household, and there is a 15% discount on the capital disposable capital, and there is a cap of 1 million. But we don't think those go far enough. On the new definition of household, we find that for some patients, they have to support young people who are over 18 years old and who are not employed or in school. Under the new definition, these patients are in fact paying more. Well, you said that you would exercise discretion to handle these cases, but how will you exercise your discretion? Can you write out that criteria more clearly so that the social workers will know how to follow up appropriately? So I hope the government or the HA can set out the criteria clearly. As to the question of income, the net assets will be discounted by 50%. But then for the income, there is no discount. They may earn a certain income today, but that they may not necessarily earn the same income in the future. And the household the household's income may also be lowered because the family members have to take care of the patient. And the cumulative income is not taken into account as well. Apart from expenditure on drugs, there are also expenses on other aspects when caring for the patient. So there is no deduction now. So the as far as income, there should also be a 50% discount. The HA has earlier said that in case income changes, that can be raised with the scheme. But that has worked That has been the case all along, but a lot of patients don't know that they have the right to tell the social workers that there has been a change in their income. So there should be a 50% discount in the income as well. In terms of the co-payment ratio, I think the asset band should also be widened so that the patients do not have to pay so much. And also the contribution ratio should be lowered to 10%. In our submission, I have also proposed other enhancement measures. I will not go into those. So what matters most is that when HA draws up the clinical guidelines, it should talk to the patients and the patients' groups. Next one, Mr. Chang Kinping. Thank you, Chairman. Please switch on the mic for Mr. Chang. Thank you, Chairman. I represent the Hong Kong Alliance for Rare Diseases. Our detailed proposals are in our submission. So today, I'm going to talk about the cap on the contribution ratio. We are talking about 20% today. Some members and deputations said that 20% is too high. Let's lower it to 10%. So whether it's 20% or 10% is really a subjective proposal. Why not 8% or 7.5%? So we are proposing that the cap should be set based on the net return of the exchange fund on an annual basis, because it reflects the trend for the increase in asset value of the Hong Kong government. If we use this percentage, that would be best. Let's use that as the basis. So that means it will not eat into the savings or the assets of the patients. And also, those who can afford should be asked to pay more. So say if the asset is high, then based on the return of the exchange fund, the patient should be paying more. I think that's a more logical way to calculate the contribution ratio. And it is not a subjective approach. We will look at the Norman Chan's management of the asset. If the value added is high, then the patient should pay more. So we should also look at the average over a 10-year period, because it will be more representative. It will not be subject to great fluctuations. So I hope the government can consider this. Maybe you cannot do it this time, but in future adjustments, please consider this. Whether you set it as, say, 10% or 20%, you would get it fixed, say, for 10 years. But then if we use the exchange fund approach, then we will be seeing a different percentage year from year.
Next, Mr. Lai Kar-wai. Chairman, administration representatives, members, good morning. I am a patient of a rare disease. Well, I have 4 points to make in relation to the SSF and the SF and the CCF. First, in relation to the definition of the applicant under special circumstances. First of all, I know that there are quite a lot of patients whose families suffer from a huge financial burden. As a result, they decided not to apply for SF assistance, and recently they've decided to apply for SF. But there are also struggles. For example, for adult members, they may have some intellectual or physical disabilities. Well, of course, for these patients, they would like to be treated as single-person household to alleviate the burden of the family members. However, if the applicant isn't a mentally disabled person, and if this person is above the age of 18, then the patient would very much hope that this member of the family can be included in the calculation of household members, and I hope that the administration can exercise discretion and allow the patient to decide the calculation of household size so as to alleviate the financial burden. Second, well, about the monthly allowable deductions, especially in terms of income, to reflect the situation of the households, more items should be included, such as daily consumables, medical items, and also the expenditure on hiring carers. Well, suggestions have been made by other organizations, and this exercise, the administration hasn't changed the formula. And about the sliding scale formula and also the percentage cap, there is still room for further revising the cap. According to the sliding scale formula, well, for the annual disposable financial resources ranging from 0 to 180,001 dollars, the percentage would range from 0 to 20%. It is very drastic. It should be further adjusted. And there should also be strengthening of communication between social worker and social community, nurses and family members. I understand that some patients have failed to apply for the SF because of lack of knowledge, and the patients had only learned about the assistance subsequently from other patients. So the communication should be improved. I'll give the floor to Mr. Zhang. Can you hear me? Yes. I'd like to speak about CCF. CCF is set up to help the underprivileged in the community. Today, I'd like to speak on behalf of elderly patients who are chronically ill. The CCF is supposed to help the severely disabled. Why should there be an age limit? The upper age limit is 65 years of age, and I think it is very unreasonable. For patients who are severely disabled living in the community, it is very unreasonable. In fact, the amount should go up. And I'm talking about severely disabled persons. Their physical condition deteriorates rapidly. Well, if they live in the community, they do not receive the care of a home. I think that if these patients lived in the care home, the cost would definitely be higher. So I think the administration should provide more help. Don't cut the $2,000 allowance for them. It is unreasonable. I hope the administration would review the system and see if it can be improved. It must not go on like this. This group of people suffers a lot. Next, CCF can allocate resources to help those non-CSSA recipients to pay for the cost of repairing wheelchairs. Well, their families may take care of them financially, but when the wheelchairs need fixing or when a new wheelchair is needed, the family may not be able to afford it. So I hope allowance can be given to them for the purchase or repair of wheelchairs. Next, Mr. Wu Chawai. Chairman, members, good morning. I'd like to also focus on patients above the age of 60. Under SF and CCF, there is a means test applicable to retirees as well. But according to Hong Kong 01 and the Hong Kong Economic Times reports, well, we need at least $5.05 million to maintain the standard of living, and even for singletons, some $1 million. So if we take a look at the written submission of the Long-Term Care Alliance, well, the cap will be $500,000. Well, for these retirees, they may have retirement savings, and the retirement savings may not be sufficient. So shouldn't they be allowed to apply for assistance? Well, it is said that the CCF provides a similar safety net as the HA safety net. And in fact, in April, according to the Housing Department, the well-off tenants policy was put in place. And for elderly applicants above the age of 60, they would be exempted from the means test. I wonder if the same can be applied to applicants of CCF. Another point of SF and CCF. Now we've spotted another problem. The time of approving application will be counted. So at the time of dispensing drugs, if the patient hasn't his own savings, the patient will not be able to purchase any drugs. The patient must wait for the application under SF or CCF to be approved first. So it is a great departure from what the government says, that no one is denied adequate medical treatment due to lack of means. For the CCF and SF applicants, even if the application is approved, the medical doctor may decide to change the dosage or the prescription. Say the dosage may go up, and the SF or CCF may not cover this change because a doctor has already approved a particular kind of drug with a dosage of 140 grams. So the patient will need to pay for the additional amount. We question whether there is any flexibility at all under the SF and CCF, and whether they are putting people first. Next, Mr. Kwok Wing Kim. I speak on behalf of the Labour Party. I think that this enhancement measure is better than nothing. It is just a small step towards policy improvement, because apart from revising the means test mechanism and the amount of assistance, the biggest problem is that the scope is not wide enough. Well, according to the HA's Drug Recommendation Committee, between 2013 and 2017, less than half of the total applications were approved. We must understand that these applications have gone through very complicated procedures, and they are supported by medical literature. But only less than half of these applications can be included in the drug formulary. Going back to the means test mechanism, little progress has been made to improve the mechanism. In 2011-2012, there was an improvement. It was relaxed, and we waited some 6 years until now, when 50% would be offered to the ADFR calculation formula. Second, 50% would be applied to net assets, but there will not be any discount to the income. So is it fair to high-income earners? Well, it deals a great blow to any household with a patient which would like to save up or prepare for the future. So we question why there is only a discount for net assets but not the household income. After all, it is not an astronomical amount. The whole measure would cost the government an additional $200 million. Over the past 10 years, every year, we spend over $10 billion on tax refunds and rates rebates. And this year, the amount even increased to $38.3 billion. According to HA statistics and the DH statistics, in 2016, only billion dollars was spent on medical expenses, that our drug expenses, that's 0.25% of our GDP. Comparing to other OECDs, that is 0.8%, we fall short by 0.55%. So if the amount isn't really that substantial, why can't we substantially relax the means test mechanism so that more drugs can be captured by the DF, so that patients don't need to pay for these drugs out of their own pockets? Okay, we have received all the deputations, and I will invite the administration to respond first before I open the floor for members, including Dr. Fernando Cheung, Mr. Ray Chen, other members, Mr. Eddie Chu, and myself. I will first invite the administration to respond. Thank you. Thank you, Chairman. This meeting is about review findings of means test mechanism for Samaritan Fund and Community Care Fund medical assistance programs. And I'd like to thank all the deputations here for offering us valuable views on the matter. Well, we understand that financial burden is imposed on needy patients because of drug expenses, and there is also pressure because of the means test mechanism and calculation of net assets. Under the previous calculation formula, the income of family members or the financial status of family members would also be taken into account, leading to some household conflicts. We agree that enhancement measures should be put in place. The review, therefore, is focused on excluding members of the family which should not be, or who should not be counted towards the household income, so that patients who, under the new revised mechanism, would not need to pay more. And we have therefore revised the calculation formula. For frontline social workers, they would make sure that under the new formula, the patient will not be required to pay more. For monthly allowable deductions, well, we try to capture the middle class because some drugs may be ultra expensive, and this may be a factor affecting in the long term household in assets. So under the new formula, 50% will be applied to the disposable capital of the household. We have heeded the concerns of the community, and we try to provide better support.
Well, some people support our proposal, and some others, including those now here, are proposing further refinements. So we will be further reviewing the details in the mechanism under SF and CCF so as to further enhance these schemes. Members, over to you. Dr. Fernando Zhang, 5 minutes, including questions and answers. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you for the deputations for coming. I think the deputations have made specific proposals. They are the people who are directly affected. Many patients, many of you have gone through struggles. We are an affluent city, and we should not plunge our people into a plight because of their illnesses. Now, this co-payment mechanism will still allow that to happen. The Undersecretary said that there would be a 50% discount to the net assets. But you are not doing it once for all. That would be done on an annual basis. Say, for example, you have $1 million there and you try to protect the $500,000. But then in the first year, you spend $100,000. So you're left with $900,000 in the next year. And then you will have a 50% discount to that. So if you are on drugs for, say, 10 years or so, your assets will be depleted. And at the end of the day, you will not have any assets left. So the mechanism itself is not going by the principle that I mentioned. So that is, people should not be plunged into poverty because of their illnesses. And a lot of families have to struggle because of this. So far, we've not heard the government making improvement in that regard. And I'm not going to repeat the points made by the deputations, especially when they talk about deductible allowances related to treatment of the diseases. These are not included either. In the interest of time, Chairman, I would like to ask, what will happen next? The government says that in January, the proposed mechanism will be launched. And today, they are here to listen to views. So is there any room still for them to make further improvement? Will they make improvement? If yes, when will they roll out a scheme which is further enhanced? And after that is launched, will there be any review mechanism, i.e. whether you will come back in 1 year's time to conduct a review on whether there are still problems in relation to this new mechanism? Can you explain the way forward? Undersecretary, thank you, Dr. Zhang, for your question. On this new scheme, for those who have made the application for the subsidy and for those who are being assisted now, they would be paying $30,000 in drugs in the future. And we believe that under the enhanced mechanism, more people will be exempted, so there will be an increase of 30% in the number of applicants. So we hope to launch the scheme as soon as possible to help those who are in need, who have not yet been covered by the safety net yet. Now, we may have to further refine certain implementation details once the schemes are launched. And as we handle more cases, we will be probably seeing new problems. And in the future, we will come back and update you on whether there is room for refinement or enhancement in terms of the procedures. And maybe if some applicants will bump into certain difficulties, how we will handle those. And in the next round of enhancement, we will certainly take into the actual experience. We will update you. Well, the Undersecretary sounds very vague. So you said ASAP, when will you launch the scheme? You said that there will be further enhancement in the future. How will it be done? Is there a certain mechanism to be set up whereby the patients and their family members can directly communicate with you? To tell you what the problems they encounter. You seem to be operating within a black box. We don't know how you operate. So can you be more clearer on the mechanism? What will happen when, and when will a review be conducted? So can I defer to the HA colleague to talk about the timeline? We will, in February, implement the enhancement measures under our schemes. For ultra-expensive drugs, because of the high drug cost, we propose that it can be launched in January, if it is passed by the Commission on Poverty in mid-January, that will go first. Why are we not doing it at one go at the same time? Because we need to adjust the current IT system. So that's why these two measures are launched differently. So can you reply in writing? What do you mean by ultra-expensive drugs we don't know? You said mid-January. What drugs will be covered? So can you reply in writing, please? Next one, Dr. Kwakaki. Thank you, Chairman. I would like to thank Mr. Raymond Chan for allowing me to speak first. Well, thank you, deputations, for coming. The most important point is, Chairman, well, it's better than nothing, because many deputations that the existing mechanism is so unreasonable, and there are a lot of worries among the patients. Well, I think the proposed measures don't go far enough. You are still very miserly here. You are not making the calculations once and for all, but rather you are having an annual vetting of the assets. If you have to understand that for chronically ill patients, cancer patients who can't work, well, they may have a fixed assets only. I mean, their assets is what they've got left only. And if you have to vet them, the assets on an annual basis, that poses great pressure on them. Well, imagine the officials here. You imagine that you have a family member who suffers from cancer, and he doesn't work, he can't work, and he maybe has to provide for support the entire family, and he has to pay for the drugs. So how can you vet their assets on an annual basis? Their assets will be depleted one day. So why are you taking such an unsympathetic approach? Then they are also worried about the discretion to be exercised by the social workers. Well, this is not a transparent approach. In the meeting last time, I asked why, how do they exercise their discretion? They said they will ask their supervisors. I don't think that's acceptable. Why don't you take a snapshot instead, and then have it, and have that snapshot asset fixed until the illness is fully cured. Second, we should have an appeal mechanism. The HA has a relatively transparent committee dealing with appeals comprising, say, lay members, representatives from the patients, and representatives from family members. They will look at these, the appeal cases. So these are two specific questions that I'm looking for an answer from the administration. Undersecretary, can I defer to the HA to explain the issue about discretion? Well, please answer my question about snapshot. Don't look at them on an annual basis. This is an outrageous approach. The enhanced scheme is already a step forward compared to the existing scheme. Well, do you understand me? While they are suffering from heavy illnesses, you are still looking at their assets on an annual basis. Maybe you, well, take a more humane approach, say, look at their assets once every 5 years, perhaps. Well, we still have the annual process under our proposal on enhanced measures. I think this is a relatively transparent approach. We should make the best use of our resources to help the needy patients. Maybe these social workers have been following up on certain cases. Maybe the procedures can be streamlined and made smoother. But then as far as the period is concerned, we are not going to change our proposed measures. Now, in future reviews, can that be taken on board? Well, we have an open mind. So can I ask the HA colleague to talk about discretion and appeal? Let me explain here. We have refined the household definition this time. Let me try to explain a bit further here. The revision is that if this is a non-dependent patient, if it is married, then his parents' income and assets will not be counted, while his spouse and dependent children's income and assets will be calculated. But if he is a non-dependent patient, if he is unmarried, he will be treated as a single person household. Many patient groups have told us maybe he is a non-dependent patient, but very often, while the parents living with him don't earn any income and they depend on him. So how will the arrangement be like? When we implement the new measures, we will treat these cases as special cases. We will exercise our discretion on a case-by-case basis. In our application guidelines, we will let patients know that if there is a non-dependent patient who is supporting his parents, then the parents can be included in the means test. So his allowance will not go down because of this. So when we roll out the plans, we would make that clear in our publicity leaflets, and there will be clear guidelines issued to social workers to reassure patients. So I would like to make that clear. It's not the case that the social workers will exercise discretion on a case-by-case basis. If there are family members living together with the patient who are supported by the patient, then those can be included as well, and the allowance can still be kept. So is there a mechanism for the family members to make an appeal? Well, you can answer yes or no. No, we don't yet have an appeal mechanism. Well, the head of department of the hospital can deal with the appeals. We have heard patients' voices. We will consider that. That means you're going to work on it. Yeah, yes. Mr. Raymond Chen, I would like to thank the deputations here. All of us would like to strive for more rights for the patients. Indeed, last week at the Health Services Panel, I moved a motion, and which was supported by a majority of the members, if not all. But the motions are logical and non-binding in nature. We would continue to follow up and put pressure on the government. There are two parts to my motion last time. The first part is to request the government to reduce the contribution ratio from 20% to 10% or below. Well, even if all electrical members ask for this, the government will not do it immediately. They said that the plan will be rolled out in February, and that the measures for the ultra-expensive drugs will be launched in January. If they have to start the discussion afresh, then I don't know how long it will take. Well, if it is lowered to 10% or 5%, how will the sums look like? Only with those figures we'll be able to know whether we should spend that amount.
Whether if we spend several hundred million dollars more, we'll be able to help the patients. The community may agree to that. But according to the administration, it is impossible to calculate. If we lower the patient contribution ratio to 10%, how much more do taxpayers have to pay? And also about the 20% maximum, after introducing this percentage for some time, will you be able to collect data and then project when you will next review the percentage, whether it will be 10 years. Next, we need to make sure under the new formula, no patient will pay extra for the drug expenses. The administration subsequently answered that it would not happen, but I wonder whether the administration had indeed used the word discretion. You need to be careful with your choice of diction, because it's quite absurd if under the new formula, patients will need to pay more. You need to make sure that the patient's contribution will not be more than that in the previous formula. And about the guidelines, the criticism is that it is not very clear. The HA has said that the guidelines are drawn up based on medical reports in other countries. Now, patients have asked about the details of these reports and the clinical standards, apart from taking reference from medical reports. Please also listen to the views of patients' organizations. I'd like to invite Mr. Lee, Lee Kok Kong, to tell us whether the patients' organizations' views would be considered. Well, in fact, at the moment, the patients do not know. When I applied for the assistance, because I did not meet the criteria, my application was not successful. The information index at the time was already some 30 plus, and I experienced great pain. I had inflammations and the spinal cord was also painful, and near the neck I was very rigid. So I will also hope that there could be greater transparency. And I also hope there will be a chance for patients' organizations to express our views to doctors. Can I also invite the administration to respond, Chairman? Now, about the criticism on the use of the word discretion, as explained just now, we're not talking about giving discretion to any individual's case. What we mean is that if the patient is required to pay more according to the new formula, the household member in question will be included, so that we make sure the amount will not be more than before. Mr. Pun Siu-Peng, I thank the deputations for expressing their views. Basically, they have agreed that the enhancement measures are better than nothing, but if possible, there should be further enhancements. Well, I am also concerned about discretionary approach and also the appeal mechanism. When patients apply for assistance under the two programs, if the application is not successful, there should be an appeal mechanism. The administration just now replied that they would consider it. I'd like to know the timetable, when they would tell us the precise arrangement about the appeal mechanism. And in February 2019, it is said that the enhancement measures will roll out, and then there will be a review. And I'd like to know when a review will be conducted. Do you have a specific timetable after its implementation? Now, the government always says that no one is denied adequate medical treatment due to lack of means, and any needy patient may apply for a Samaritan Fund and Community Care Fund for assistance. Now, there is a point I don't understand. According to some deputations, the upper age limit will be capped at 60. So the assistance will be cut when a patient reaches the age of 60, I'd like to have more details about the amount involved for patients about the age of 60 and the amount of funding cut. And the secretary, I'd just like to refer to the point about $2,000. There is no age consideration in terms of drug expenses. I think probably the deputations were referring to another aspect of the programs. I'm sorry, I cannot answer this question now. I need to go back and find out more about that. About the mechanism, it is currently dealt with by the HA office. But I think that if we are to escalate the appeal mechanism to a higher level, the headquarters will conduct a review as soon as possible. Yes, the enhancement measures will be rolled out in January or February 2019, and by then data will be collected and the views will be heard, and it will be a year at least for a preliminary review to be conducted. And about setting up a mechanism as soon as possible, can you tell us when and what difficulties there are? I'll defer to the HA colleague to explain about the difficulties. We do have an appeal mechanism, albeit not at the headquarters level. If we are to set up a mechanism at the headquarters level, we need to set down, first of all, the criteria and the procedures. So next year, in the first quarter, when we roll out the enhancement measures, we would like to implement the appeal mechanism for the enhancement measures as soon as possible. And details will be announced. Any follow-up? Next, Mr. Eddie Zhu. Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to pick up on Mr. Ray Chen's point. He asked a question on behalf of Mr. Lee Kok Kong. He doesn't meet the clinical standards, so he's not eligible for the assistance. And he just now quoted from a professor who said that the criteria should be relaxed, so that more patients suffering from AS could get the help they need. So for this condition of AS, ankylosing spondylitis, what can be done to relax the criteria? That's my first question. Why don't you answer this first? Who would take the question? Dr. Zhang? Thank you, Mr. Diju, for your question. It's hard to comment on individual cases. As far as the mechanism is concerned, we need to make reference to the international standards, because each drug may come with side effects, and some drugs have only been used for a few years or 10 years. Because of the short time span, it's difficult to collect evidence on side effects of the drugs. And as evidence shows, in some cases, the drugs may damage other organs. We need to communicate with the patients. So as explained just now, once every 2 years, we would discuss with the patients' organizations on the procurement of drugs and about issues of their concern. We also exchange views with these organizations. We let them know our difficulties and our circumstances. We hope to further enhance communication so that we can break the barrier with patients. We will be meeting all the patient organizations in due course for the Hong Kong ASA. We've actually met them and will continue to enlist their help. So according to Dr. Zhang, they are thinking for you. They don't want you to have so many side effects because of the drugs. because your condition is not that serious, so it's not about money. Well, it's about clinical evidence, weighing the pros and cons of the drugs, and also the patient's conditions also differ. We can't rely on just a fixed set of standards. We need to consider other matters such as recurrence rate, etc. So we leave the assessment to clinicians. Of course, we also base our discussion on the framework. But as I mentioned, we cannot just rely on one set of indicators. We need to communicate and see how we can further enhance the mechanism. Thank you, Chairman. I still have a minute or so. I'd like to invite Mr. Lee or Mr. Pang to respond to what Dr. Zhang said. Mr. Lee or Mr. Pang? Of course, more exchange would be good, but it's not just about exchange of views. It is about how you can take on the experience of patients in using the drug and adjust your clinical method. So it's part of the mechanism in deciding the circumstances in which the drug should be applied. You should not just base your assessment on international medical reports, but also on the patient's own experience of using the drug. Mr. Lee. Well, I've suffered from AS for 25 years, and what he said really drives me to tears. That means your consideration is not putting patients' interests first. Of course, when we run out of money, we need to apply for financial assistance, but because of a certain criteria, our application is not successful. Well, in fact, according to recent medical research, inflammation index may not truly reflect the condition of patients. Some patients may have normal inflammatory index, and yet they are required to use bioagents. I want to know, under your clinical standards at the moment, whether these patients will be captured by the SF. Mr. Roy Kwong, I thank Mr. Lee and other deputations because you're speaking from your own experience. Under the new mechanism, you may need to rely on the authority's discretion in order to be included in the program. Well, first of all, we all know that the motion moved without notice was passed, that the maximum ratio of patient contribution to drug expenses should be further revised to 10% or below. First of all, I'd like to hear from the administration whether 20% is reasonable in your view. And if not, if you'd like to take a step further in helping patients and their families, and would like to lower the ratio to 10%, I want to know whether you have a timetable, whether you have considered that, and whether you what your position is. Undersecretary, we commissioned the Chinese University of Hong Kong to conduct the review, and the review findings have been incorporated in the enhancement measures. So at the moment, our goal is to implement the enhancement measures as soon as possible. As for further enhancements in the future, there may be other views to be considered, views that we have already heard on other areas of enhancement. So by then, the patient contribution ratio may is just one of the indicators. We'll all take a comprehensive review of the matter.
Dr. Che, for such enhancement measures, from the perspective of the patients, these are not easy to come by. We hope that these is just a first step. We hope that more can be done in the future. In terms of the contribution ratio, that may be just one indicator. I hope that the government can be more specific. When the report was first released, the administration said that in relation to 20%, we are talking about expensive drugs. 20% will already pose a tremendous pressure on the patients. This has been the stance expressed previously by the administration. Has that stance changed? On supporting patients in need, we will not just do one round of enhancement measure. Over the years, we have been working on including more drugs, increasing the subsidy. We have been taking a progressive and orderly approach in enhancing the various measures. Why are we having this enhancement exercise this time? Because we're seeing the surfacing of ultra-expensive drugs, which can deplete households' assets. And then also, in the course of application, the different family members have to hand over their income and asset information, bringing conflicts among family members. We will take a further step, taking into account the trends of drug costs internationally. If the drugs get more expensive in the future, we will conduct another review. We will not rule out that possibility. Dr. Choi, patients can't wait. We know that this is a lengthy process. We are looking at time in years. But then the patients are looking at time rather in days because they are suffering from pain every day. So we need a new policy. Say if we have a 20% cap in the contribution ratio now, when will you come back to the LegCo to make another proposal? Say in 1 to 2 years' time, can we be given a specific time frame so that we know that you will proceed with further helping the patients? We can't give you a definite timeline. After the new mechanism has been implemented, we will collect data on the number of new cases and also existing cases and the difficulties they encounter under the new mechanism. We need 1 year to collect enough data to come back and update you on the progress of the implementation of the new mechanism and the way forward. Dr. An Zhang, thank you, Chairman. Many deputations have referred to the SM and CCF and their various aspirations. I hope that the government can seriously consider them. In relation to the appeal mechanism, the administration said they will consider setting up one. I hope that you can do it as early as possible. An appeal panel may be set up, and I think you should exercise flexibility in the course of doing so. Well, those who would like to apply for SF, they are definitely not rich people, and they are at the same time suffering from diseases, so they are in the dire strait, and they need the government's assistance. They need the SF to help them. There may be marginal cases, and appeal may be lodged with the appeal panel. I hope that you can set up more lenient criteria. We should consider things with a sympathetic angle. This is my aspiration. And then we talk about single-person household. If you don't allow for deductible allowance for the parents, I see a lot of people who are single and married, and among the siblings, because they are married, they support more their parents than the other siblings. So if there is no allowance deducted for providing for the parents, then that's not fair. The administration's response is that they will factor that in. I hope that in your formal guidelines, the administration's response today should be set out clearly in the guidelines. And then I always have a question mark, Chairman. I have received views from members of the public saying that for a 2P family earning an income of $21,000 or above, then they are not eligible. But then if they make $22,000, what will happen? Does it mean that they should ask the company to slash their salary? Well, if they can't apply under the scheme, then they have to pay 100% of the drug costs. So that makes a huge difference to these people. So for a single-person household, the line is at $11,000. How do you drop those lines? Can you relax the criterion? And in exceptional circumstances, can applications still be approved? So who will respond? Ms. Chung. Thank you, Member, for your questions. Let me explain the means test mechanism. There is not a line defining who are eligible. We will consider the income and the asset, and then we will come up with the ADFR. Now, as to the level of subsidy to be granted, it depends really on the cost of the drug. Put in simple terms, for a cheap drug, they may not be eligible. But if we are talking about expensive drugs, then they can get the subsidy. So it depends on the cost of the drug that the person is on. Just now we mentioned there is a single person, but then he has to support the parents, and then there may also be family members living under the same roof who have to be supported by the patient. We have heard views from members and the patients in that regard. In our publicity leaflet, all these scenarios will be set out clearly so that the patients know that they can raise these concerns with the social worker, who can then factor in those in coming up with the ADFR. I will move a motion, and I will hand it over to you very soon. I hope that can be handled today. Ms. Rebecca Chan, followed by myself, and then there is another deputation who arrived late. I will give him the chance to speak. Thank you, Chairman. The administration referred to the enhanced measures for the means test mechanism. You want to implement them as soon as possible. You haven't been able to give me a timetable on the review, which is important. Many other members and patient groups and patients' representatives want further enhancement. You must give us a clear timetable. Well, at least you should tell us whether you would do a review in 1 year or 2 years' time. You should give us a definite timetable on to assess whether the enhanced measures have worked well. And I would like to thank the patients' groups for your views. Will the administration consider that in the long run, when you review the men's test mechanism, can you set up a mechanism, a regular mechanism, to hear patients' views on further enhancing the means test mechanism? Thank you. Ms. Chan, after the new enhancement measures have been implemented, it will take time for us to collect the relevant data as to whether there will be new applications, because we believe that after the scheme is enhanced, more people will be eligible for the subsidy. And right now, we're just making projections as to the actual number of new applications. We need 1 year to collect the relevant data. Now, Many members and deputations have referred to different possible scenarios. They don't want to pay more than what they're paying now. And some dependent family members should also be taken into account in calculating the assets and so on and so forth. There might be an initial period whereby the applicants have to learn about the new procedures and the new mechanism. So maybe in 1 year's time, we can explain to members the actual implementation of the enhancement measures. But as to when further enhancement measures will be made, we don't have a timetable yet. We will adopt a gradual and orderly approach in looking at the different aspects under the new mechanism, the overall pressure on the applicants, and so on. Now, how patients can participate? I have referred to certain approaches to be adopted. First, we will take into account international literature and local healthcare professionals' views in including new drugs into HA. That is done twice every year. And after that is done, then these drugs will be considered by the SF and the CCF. And we have also had patients' views that in this mechanism, can they first talk to the patients. They have already enhanced the relevant mechanism. They are dividing the patients into different categories. They're used to meet all the patients at one go, but then now they are grouping the patients under different categories and meet with them. So this was the enhancement made. Chairman, patients' views are very important. Why don't you set up a regular, say, consultative mechanism under the SF? You will be meeting them regularly, right? So Tim Pang also said that, well, you should not just listen to international experts' views, you should also listen to local patients' views. Can you include patients into a regular consultative mechanism to be set up? Well, every year we would be meeting patient groups several times a year in considering including drugs into the HA form, into the drug formulary. We would be listening to patients. It is my turn to ask. And Dr. N. Zhang is moving a motion which is related to the subject matter. The motion is now being copied. We need a quorum to deal with the motion. How many people are we lacking? We need a total of 7 members. I will be the last one to speak, and then I will ask Mr. Leung Kwok Hong to speak. I have to go to support Mr. Andrew Wang and Mr. Lam Chuk Ting, so I arrived late. So I don't think the government is sincere. In the paper, it is said that there will be an increase of 30% in the number of new applications. Well, you have made this projection of 30%. Already. The panel on health services have passed 2 motions. One is making the 50% discount a permanent measure and that the asset should not be calculated on an annual basis. And then the contribution ratio of the disposable capital should be cut from 20% to 10%.
In other words, it's very clear the objective is to alleviate the burden on patients suffering from rare diseases and the burden on their family members. How long will it take? The panel on health services already passed 2 motions, and that's the reason we are having these 2 meetings. Both motions were passed in November, and we are close to the break. And you still don't have any direction. So are you treating the motion that have been passed real or not? In fact, it's very simple. Under the enhancement measures, you need to pay about $10,000 more for each case. And we're talking about an annual additional expenditure of $500,000. Last year, Carrie Lam dished out $40 billion for tax refund. So taking 1% out of that, that's $500 million. You'll be able to resolve all these problems, not to mention reforming the advisory structure, not to mention expensive drugs. I don't know whether Dr. Chen will ask you the same in a moment, but you need to respond to the motions passed by the Legislative Council. That is what you must do. Don't think by prosecuting legislative members with the help of the pro-establishment camp, you can get away with it. This is what you must do. Thank you. We need to ring the bell now to remind them to perhaps vote on Dr. Anne Chang's motion. And next is my turn. I have 5 minutes. Well, I've heard views expressed just now, and whether it's from members, from patients, from deputations, you need to find more financial resources. At the same time, you need to reduce expenses. About ultra-expensive drugs, well, let me give you my experience. About a decade ago, the DHA originally did not allow patients to purchase their own drugs. It would not be captured by the safety net. At first, a drug would cost $20, and that would be regarded as ultra-expensive drugs. And about 10 years ago, it costs about $30,000 a month for target drugs to treat cancer patients. Well, now for ultra-expensive drugs, after I've become a legal member, we're talking about some $3 million. So you see the exponential increase in terms of drug costs. So on the one hand, we're striving for more funding. On the other hand, is it really possible to ask pharmaceutical companies to be compassionate? Because they're after all profit-making companies. They must make a profit. And let me give you this reminder. I attended an international conference recently. The conference was about a drug to treat liver disease. In Hong Kong, a treatment originally would cost $500,000, and then recently the cost has been lowered to $100,000. In a neighboring city, however, with the help of the government, it only cost several $10,000. It just takes a several hour flight to that place. And the doctor there even invited me to ask patients to go to their hospitals. And it's really an embarrassment. Whereas for our government, the government is saying no. And this is very bad. And then coming back to the point about CCF, there is an extra item, some $30 million on ultra-expensive drugs. I'd like to know the details, the criteria, CCF ultra-expensive drugs program. Can we allocate some funding to this program? Can you give me the operational details? Because yesterday and today, I've noticed that notice this point. And today we do not have anyone representing the CCF. Now, about the two types of drugs, liver disease, a treatment would cost several hundred thousand dollars, and it would completely cure the liver disease. Whereas for the other type, cancer drugs, we're talking about $4 or $5 million a year, not to completely cure the cancer illness, but to prolong the lifespan of patients. Now, as far as I'm concerned, as an outpatient physician, I would, of course, consider the patient's case from my perspective. Well, we have 20,000 hepatitis C patients in Hong Kong. And then I could just dispense the drugs and spend the five-year funding on the CCF in one go. So you need to consider very carefully how we deal with this embarrassment, because like I mentioned, the doctor from another city already mentioned that there is no hope in Hong Kong and you should ask patients to come to us. And that happened at an international conference. It's really an embarrassment. I'll give you time to respond. Thank you, Chairman, for your comment. As I understand, the HA already has a mechanism of negotiating with the pharmaceutical companies. Let me remind you that every drug has to be registered with you. So you are the gatekeeper. Let's invite the HA to answer your other point. No, that's it. My speaking time limit is up. I need to observe that as well. We have a quorum, and I have a motion to deal with. So I will invite Dr. Ann Chang to read out your motion. Thank you, Chairman. In relation to the review findings of mean test mechanism for Samaritan Fund and Community Care Fund medical assistance programs, this panel urges the government first, further at lower the contribution ratio of patients to drug expenses to below 10% of the ADFR of the patient or $500,000 to effectively alleviate the financial burden on the patient and their family. Second, to further relax the definition of household so that a patient can apply for assistance as a singleton without having to calculate the income and assets of the family members, so that the allowance would be more appropriate to the patient. Third, if the applicant can prove that there are family members under his who are dependent on him in calculating the annual total income, the family members should be counted towards the applicant's dependent member. What about point number four? It's not the same as that projected on the screen. Well, let me supplement the amended version later. The version that I read prevails. An appeal mechanism should be set up for reviewing the approval decisions and the contribution payment, because I added this appeal mechanism point. Why don't you put that on the screen instead? Yes, Mr. Zhu. I want to know whether there is a second round, Chairman. Yes. Thank you. I'm sorry, Chairman. Because after listening to other views, I mean, I need to add more points. But you need to show me first. As a matter of procedure, you are also chair of another panel. You know that. We need to deal with that. Well, because I've noticed what you read out differed from what was projected on the screen. So please take a look at this version. this version prevails. This version has just been read out by Dr. N. Chang. Those in favor of the motion, please raise your hand. 10. Those against? No. None. Abstentions? None. All right, motion passed. Second round. Mr. Adiju. 4 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. I have two questions. Well, not a question per se. Well, if we insist that the government relax the means test, the drug expenses may still go up, and in the end, the actual patient's contribution to drug expenses may not come down. I'd like the government to give us some figures. In 2017-18, there were 4,405 cases, and the subsidy amount of was $530 million. Now the upper limit is capped at $1 million at the moment. Can you compare and contrast? Give us a table, for example, $500,000 a year, and then in the past 5 years, the patient's contribution to drug expenses by year to see if there is an upward trend. Because this could reflect the increase in drug expenses. So I'd like the administration to give us that first of all. Second, I don't quite understand from the paper which referred to a point. After introducing enhancement measures, there would be an additional 30% of applications received. I don't quite understand, because according to HA just now, the means test only relates to patients' contribution to drug expenses. It is not related to having any income or asset limit. So I don't understand why there would be a 30% increase in the number of applications. And about the 4,405 cases receiving subsidy, apart from these 4,000 plus cases, how many applications were received and how many applications were unsuccessful, and the reason for rejecting their applications? Perhaps you can give a written reply to Mr. Adiju and also supplement here orally. Thank you, Mr. Ju, for his questions. Let me first explain about the 30% increase in the number of applications. We just now explained that we will not draw a line on the income and asset thresholds as eligibility criterion. So why would there be an increase? That is, under the existing means test mechanism, depending on the drug expenses and the drug to be used, for example, if drug A is used, little subsidy will be provided, and if drug B is used, which is more expensive, then more subsidy will be provided. So under the revised ADFR formula, a household may originally be ineligible using the existing formula, but because of the change in the contribution ratio under the new formula, they could become eligible, and our estimation is that there would be a 30% increase.
Can you also answer the cases? 4,405, how many cases have been declined? Well, let me explain the application procedures. I think the formula It's very clear, and it's made known to the patient. So the medical social worker will explain the income and asset calculation to the patients. Now, for individual patients, they after they've learned about how it's calculated, they would withdraw the application. And sometimes, some other patients, they would hope that the medical social worker can make the calculations. Now, the 4,405 cases have been approved. And then for some other cases, we do have figures on unsuccessful cases. The number is relatively few. But for many cases, the individuals withdraw the applications after our explanation. For those whose applications have been declined, do they include or not the people who do not meet with the relevant clinical guidelines? Well, the applicants must have met all have met with the clinical criteria. I don't have the figures on those applications. They don't have it. Can you retrieve the information? Well, the individual would like to get the subsidy, but he can't meet the clinical criteria, so his application fails. I mean, do you have the numbers? Well, we'll try to dig out the information. Dr. Elizabeth Quart, first round, 5 minutes. Sorry, I've fallen ill for several days. I've lost my voice. I think our suggestions are very clear. Ms. Dr. An Zheng and Mr. Chen Hanpan have moved a motion which has been passed, and our views have been made clear in that motion, and this is supported by different members across the different political parties. So I don't think the government should shy away from that. You refuse to tell us when you will conduct another review. You say it's roughly 1 year before you come back to us. Can the government undertake that there will be a review after 1 year, and then 1.5 years later, you will come back to the Legco to make proposals on further enhancement measures so that our patients know how long they should further wait? We will not stand in the way of your present proposal. A lot of patients are waiting. They want to be included in the mechanism. We will not stop you. But then the mechanism is not good enough still. And a lot of patients and their families are still very concerned. So can you undertake here that 1.5 years later, you will come back? And then patients will still harbor hope for the future after they've accepted the present proposal. And thank you, the deputations, for coming here. Undersecretary, any timetable on review? Thank you, member, for your question. We note the member's motion, and we would put it on record. As I said, we will collect data after the enhanced measures have been implemented. We will conduct an interim review as to exactly when there will be another exercise for enhancement. We don't have a concrete timeline now. We promise that we will continue to enhance the schemes. That has been done in the past. We will continue to do so in the future because there is a great time gap between each review exercise. We don't want to wait for many years before another review is conducted. You said that in the next year, you will collect data, you will continue to listen to patients' views to find out the problems they encounter and look for ways to improve. Now, we give you 1 year, and then you can then collate the data in half a year. Then you come back in a 1.5 years' time to make further proposals. I'm not saying that the further enhancement proposals must be implemented 1.5 years later. We just want to know what the comments that you have collected and how you plan to further enhance. This is not a too high an order to make, right? Now, well, we can do that. We can come back 1 year later to a report on the implementation of the scheme and whether there is room for improvement. Now, if we talk about large-scale review, then that will take longer. We would also factor in the points that have made in the next large-scale review. Well, you used to conduct large-scale review once in many years, but then you have a new governance style now, and you don't need to wait for many years before you conduct another major review. Anyway, that's good that you promised that you will come back in 1 year's time to tell us what's happened in the previous year, and I think that's a positive response. Any response, Under Secretary? Agree, we will update you on the progress. So far, no other member would like to ask a second round. So today, we'd like to thank the deputations for coming here to give us your views and for members raising various questions. We have two major opinions, comments. The deputations have spoken, said that users' views should be incorporated and there should be a regular mechanism to take on board those views. Now, and then also 1 year later, you should come back to report on the implementation of the enhanced measures and to ascertain whether there is room for improvement. And if needed, further review can be undertaken. Thank you very much.